Hi there. Imagine I have three tables, one of cuddly toys, one of bricks, and one of pens. And I want to combine these three tables based on their color. But which order should I join them? I'd like to start with the two tables that return the fewest rows. So in this case, that's the toys and then the bricks, and then finish by adding in the pens. But how do I know how many rows I'm going to get from each? I could go and count how many things there are in each one, but then I'm running a query to run a query. That doesn't make any sense. Instead, from time to time, I'll capture summary information about what's actually stored in each table, the table statistics. But what are these statistics and how do they help your SQL run faster? Let's find out. Table statistics give a summary of the information stored in each table. This includes details such as the total number of rows, and for each column, the highest, lowest, and number of different values it has. Using this information, the optimizer can then estimate how many rows you're going to get from each table. If you're selecting all the rows from a table, you can use the row count stat to give a good estimate. But as soon as you add a where clause, you'll only get some fraction of the rows back. The database calculates this fraction as 1 divided by the number of distinct values in the column you're filtering on. This gives the selectivity of your filter, the proportion of rows in the table the database expects this where clause to return. To estimate how many rows you'll get, it then multiplies the selectivity by the total number of rows stored in the stats to give the cardinality. So how does this work in practice? Well, let's say I want to find all the blue bricks. The optimizer estimates the selectivity of this by dividing 1 by the number of different colors there are, 3, to give 1/3. It then multiplies this by the total number of bricks, 9, to give an estimated cardinality of 3. The optimizer will then repeat this process for all other tables in the query, and then use these estimates to decide which plan to use. You can check the accuracy for these estimates by seeing if the estimated number of rows for an operation multiplied by the number of times it started roughly matches the number of rows it really returned. When these figures are in the same order of magnitude, it's likely the optimizer has found the best plan available. So, a key factor in the quality of the plan is the quality of the statistics. If these are missing, out of date, or misleading, there's a good chance the optimizer will choose the wrong plan. So, what can you do in these cases? Well, for the most part, you don't need to worry about missing or out of date, stale statistics. Modern versions of Oracle Database have a background process that will gather them for you. But if you've just archived off a whole bunch of rows, you may not want to wait for this, in which case you can gather them manually. But even with fully up-to-date statistics, the optimizer can still get its estimates completely and utterly wrong. Why? Correlation and skew. On my table here, I have red cubes, blue cuboids, and green star-shaped things. Three different colors, three different shapes. So if I'm searching for a given color, I'll get 1/3 of the bricks back. Same applies if I look for a given shape. But what happens if I search for a given color and shape? Well, that's either going to return 1/3 of the bricks too, say I look for the red cubes, or return nothing at all, say I look for green cubes. But what does the optimizer think? If you search for blue cubes, it says, there's three different colors, so the selectivity of color is 1/3. The same applies for shapes. Then by default, it gets the combined selectivity in the same way you calculate the probability of independent events, by multiplying the fractions together to get 1/9, leading to an estimated cardinality of 1. I'm never going to get this number of bricks back when searching by color and shape. I'm either going to get 3 or 0. So what can we do about this? Create extended statistics. These capture relationships between columns. By considering a group of columns as one, the database can record how many different values there are across the columns. So with extended stats on color and shape, we can now see that there are only three different combinations, and the optimizer can guess correctly again. Okay, so that solves the correlation problem. What about skew? What is this, and how do you fix it? Skew comes in two varieties, range and value. Let's start with value skew. This happens when there's an uneven spread in your values. So let's get some different bricks. So now I've got 4 blue cubes, 8 green, and 14 red cubes, meaning we've got more red bricks than blue or green put together. If I'm searching for a given color, we can no longer take the total number of bricks, divide by the number of different colors, and get an accurate estimate for how many rows the query is going to return. To fix this, we can store the number of bricks for each color. This gives a frequency histogram. Each value is stored in what's called a bucket. Provided the stats are up to date, this gives us a very accurate estimate of how many rows our query will return when searching for any of these colors. Also, if we search for a color we don't have, say pink, we can see no buckets store this value and infer we'll get few rows. Frequency histograms sound great. So why don't we create them on all columns all the time? Well, there's a limit to how many different buckets the database can create on each column. So if the number of different values is greater than the number of buckets, we can no longer store how many rows have every value. For example, let's say we add in a yellow brick. So we've got 4 colors, but we're still stuck with 3 buckets. 4 into 3 doesn't go. So what can we do? Luckily, there's a trick we can use. If the number of yellow bricks is small, such as 1, we can safely ignore it in our histogram and still get reasonable estimates when searching for yellow values because it's rare. This gives a top frequency or top N histogram. Only the most common values appear in it with the exact row counts. Any that are really rare don't appear at all. But this only works if we've got few yellow values. If we add in a whole bunch more, we can no longer safely ignore them and still get reasonable estimates when searching for yellow bricks. So we need to spread 4 values over 3 buckets, meaning each bucket covers a range of values. We aim to spread the rows evenly so each bucket has the same number of rows, giving a height-balanced histogram. With this, we know how many bricks are in each bucket and what the maximum value is in each, but not exactly how many rows there are for any given color. This can lead to overestimating rare values, such as yellow and blue, and underestimating common values, such as red. But once again, there's another trick available. The green and red bricks are spread over 2 buckets each. Let's move them so they only appear in 1 bucket each, and record how many bricks have the same color as the final one for each bucket. So we get frequency-like behavior for the last value in a bucket, but the buckets can cover as many values as we want. We've combined the benefits of frequency and height balance histograms into a hybrid histogram. This can still lead to misestimation. For example, we don't know exactly how many blue bricks there are, but it does help reduce its effect. Uneven distributions in values like this are common in your data, so histograms make sense here. But what about values that are guaranteed to be unique? Say your primary key. Here, each value can appear at most once, which leads some people to ponder an interesting question. Why has the database created a histogram on my sequence assigned primary key? It's time to discuss range skew. This occurs when there's an uneven spread between the values. Say we've numbered the bricks starting at 1. Currently, the values are all consecutive, but if we now chuck away these bricks, there's a hole in the numbers. So if we search for values between 5 and 10, we'll get no rows back. Adding a histogram helps identify these missing values. So, through a combination of having up-to-date stats, identifying column correlations by creating extended stats, also called column groups, and using histograms to identify skew, we enable the optimizer to come up with good estimates. Modern versions of Oracle Database can gather all of this for you automatically, provided you set your preferences correctly. If you have a plan where the estimates are way off and you're getting a bad plan, you may want to tweak the histogram and extended stats settings for each table. You can do this by setting table preferences. But what if the estimates are bang on and your query is still too slow? What do you do now? Well, you need to reduce the work your SQL does. So you need to see how many resources it consumes. How do you do this? We'll find out in the next episode. Thanks for watching. Do you have any questions about how to use extended stats or histograms? If so, let us know in the comments. And subscribe for more SQL magic.